Ladies and gentlemen, the violin is an extremely complex instrument that can take years to master. Today, I'm going to be answering some of the most asked questions in regards to playing violin. So let's get right into it. First question is, how tight should the bow hairs be? You gotta be very tasteful with the bow, because if it's too loose, you're not gonna have as much friction with the string. And if it's too tight, well, then you should fear for your life, because your bow might snap at any moment. What you especially don't want is for your bow to be outwardly arched. So how tight should it be? Well, if you grab like a pencil or a pen that's not too thick, you should be able to
easily kind of pass it through the middle of the bow.
Then just kind of give it a light touch. You don't want it to be too hard at the point where it's like resisting your finger, and you don't want it to be too soft either. I can't believe I'm trying this with my actual bow. So what you don't want is for the stick to be parallel completely with the bow hairs. All right, and I'll just say, make sure that after you finish practicing, you loosen the bow hairs so that there's no tension on the bow overnight. Next question is, how often should I practice? This question is very difficult to answer. First of all, I have to answer it back with a question. Are you seeking to becoming a professional violinist? Are you seeking to just play the violin for fun? Are you seeking to go into orchestra? So the answer would vary based on your goal. If you want to become a professional violin player, I'd say right from the start, a good hour a day would be a healthy way to start off, because you want to give yourself enough time to practice scales, various exercises, etudes, pieces, right? So it's hard to cram all of that in like 15-20 minutes, right? If you're just playing violin for the fun of it and you just want to become decent at it, I'd say, you know, a good 20-25 minutes a day would be good. And again, here consistency is key. Look for quality over quantity. For those of you who work out, I'm sure you've seen those kind of people in the gym who have no idea what they're doing, and they're in the gym for 2 hours and they think that they've accomplished something, when for 30 minutes straight they would just take a dumbbell and swing it around in circles thinking that they're accomplishing something. So there you go. I would say if you're a beginner violinist who just wants to do it as a hobby and to get decent at it, I'd say around 20-25 minutes a day, and just make sure to equally distribute the practicing material throughout those minutes of practicing. All right, the next question. How often do I cut my nails? Yeah, that's a good question. Sorry to discourage you, but if you want to have long nails, you won't be able to play the violin. Sorry to break it to you. So when you're playing on the violin, you always want to make sure that the tip of your finger is touching the string as well as the fingerboard, right? So when you're playing, right, you want to make sure that the tip of your fingers are directly in contact with the string and with the fingerboard. So essentially, you want to be able to touch your string without having your nail interfere between the fingerboard or the string. So I'll just say that's the general guideline you want to follow when it comes to nail length. You'll notice that some guitarists let their nails kind of grow out so that they can use them as natural picks to perform different patterns. I'm just curious, what's an animal that has long nails? Do you know what a sloth looks like? You know its nails? You want to know how long they are? Yeah, that's a length that you do not want when playing the violin. So how often do I cut my nails? As often as you need to. Before we move on to the next questions, I just want to say, if you're enjoying the content, please subscribe. Let's try and get to 5,000 subscribers by the end of August. That would really mean the world to me. Okay, let's get back to the questions. Oh, here's an interesting one. Can I sit while practicing? A lot of teachers will tell you, no, you have to stand up and practice. You know, you need to build that core in your back, support, nice posture. Posture has a lot to do with projection. Good posture can actually make your sound better, believe it or not. I suppose the reason why most teachers encourage you to practice standing up is so that you can develop that core in your back more naturally, right? Because when you're seated, you tend to kind of like shrink your elbows together and just have a crooked back. So when you're standing, you naturally kind of open yourself up. Singers in choirs, for example, they have to stand when they're singing. Why? Because it naturally opens up the airway, allowing for more projection to come out from your diaphragm, right? So it's very similar to the violin. If you think about it logically, a lot of orchestral players sit in their orchestral rehearsals. They sit while practicing for rehearsals that can last 3, 4, 5 hours. There's nothing really that damaging in sitting when playing the violin, but you have to really make sure that you're sitting with right posture. So can I practice while being seated? The answer is yes, you can. Just have a good straight back as well as a good posture. So the next question is, how much rosin should I put on my bow? That question also depends on how much you're practicing. If you practice, let's say, once every 2 months, never put rosin on your bow, okay? Don't put rosin. If you're practicing at least 3 times a week, I'd say every other day. Don't do it so seldomly where it's like once every 2 weeks, but don't do it too often where it's like once a day. So how much rosin should you put? I'd say if you haven't put some in a while, go for 20 strokes. So, and after you've done around 20 strokes, you're gonna do 7 little strokes at the frog. 7 strokes in the middle. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And at the tip, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7. And you wanna make sure to have enough pressure when you're applying the rosin, just so that you can make sure that the substance is being applied to the bow. And then after you've done this, make sure to tap it a couple of times just to make sure that the rosin powder comes off. Oh, I really like this question. Can I self-teach myself with YouTube videos? Again, for those who just want to do it as a hobby and to just kind of do it for the fun of it, yes, you can self-teach yourself with YouTube videos. Although, I have to warn you, it's going to be extremely hard. Especially with violin, such a complex instrument, you need to have someone look at your form, correct your form. You want someone to give you a tailored explanation that will help your personal progressional needs. YouTube videos just generally touch upon certain elements, but they don't dive deep enough into the explanation of like, okay, if you don't do this, the consequence of this will be this. And so in order to correct that, you can do this, this, and these exercises. And because of the way you're holding your bow, you have to do all these micro adjustments in order to have a better sound. So if you're just gonna stick with YouTube, you're not gonna be able to have the richness of having to discuss, for example, your struggles with your teacher, like, hey, I really want to play this piece. What are some exercises that you can give me in order for me to play it? And your teacher can suggest a couple of etudes, different scales, different exercises in order for you to play them. Maybe I should start a series where we look at some pieces or concertos, and I actually give you a list of different exercises that you should do in order to be able to play those concertos. Let me know if you want that in the series, by the way. So, can I self-teach myself with YouTube? Yes, with a lot of hesitation. I mean, if you want to become a professional violinist, forget about it. You need a teacher. Absolutely not. Okay, the last question we're going to answer is, what song should I play next? Oh, good question. So when you want to target a new piece, you want to make sure that it's a little bit more challenging than the piece you previously played. Or it can be a little bit more simple than the one you just played in order for you to apply more technique into it. For example, let's say you just finished playing the Vivaldi concerto and you want to maybe go to the Akkali concerto or the Bach concerto. You can choose a repertoire that's a little bit easier in order to work on different things like vibrato, sound projection. That would be a little bit more challenging to learn if you were to learn a more virtuosic piece that's more challenging for the left hand fingers. And that's again why it's important to have a teacher, because he'll know exactly what you need and what you need to work on more. Listen to a lot of repertoire, listen to a lot of pieces, listen to a lot of performers. And then when you found a piece that you really like, make sure to look through the score. If you see that there are passages that go into position, but you can't shift yet, maybe it's better to leave that piece a little bit for the future while you work on shifting exercises, for example. So being able to analyze a score will also help you appreciate music even more and to be able to find certain details like dynamics, for example, that make up the beauty of a piece. And I'd say if you're a beginner, there's tons of books that have pieces that get progressively more difficult in a packet or in a volume of books. So that can be something you can look into as well. Listen, I think that's all the questions I have for y'all today. Listen, if you want to have a question answered, leave it down in the comments. I might be able to answer you. Like this video for part 2, subscribe, and as always, go practice.